What's going on, everybody? My name is Coach Stefan, and I am the CEO of Pursuit Health and Performance, and this is the Everyday Pursuit Podcast. If you don't know, I want to tell you a little bit more about this podcast. So I created this podcast, and I called it the Everyday Pursuit because I think it's a direct reflection on what we do with our clients and a direct reflection on how I think about my life. And I've been called all types of weird, probably names and phrases by my friends and family for the fact that I feel like life is a constant pursuit. And I think there is a battle between mediocrity, people that are just, and this is nothing against them, but like people that are just like, I'm just fine here. And that always was so unsettling to me. I don't know why. Like literally it's just within me. It's not that I never am satisfied in areas of my life. It's never that I don't want to settle. I just feel like I'm in a pursuit every day to be a better, and then fill in the blank, dad, husband, a friend, like leader. Everything in my life, I actually feel less happy and more depressed not having productivity in my life and not being in pursuit of something that's bigger than me, basically, right? And it has to do with me, but like that is kind of what I think this podcast is meant for, is people that want to be in a pursuit. And you know what? I think life is a lifelong pursuit. That's all it is. You just pursue, you pursue, you pursue, and you die. And I know that sounds maybe morbid or depressing, but I actually think that's fun. And here's why. People actually agree with this. They just phrase it different. They go, life's not about the destination, it's about the journey. That's literally what I'm saying. It's about being in pursuit. And if the pursuit is fun, if the pursuit brings you life, the destination's not all it is copped up to be, I promise you. In fact, sometimes the anticipation of the destination is the fun, right? Like when I get to retirement, I know a lot of people that have like retired from things or like hit points in their life where they're like, oh, I made it. And it's almost not as green as they thought, right? The grass is not greener. They get there and they're actually sadly disappointed. And I think it's like this high and then it goes away. For example, I know a lot of people that buy trucks. I'm a truck guy. And they'll sit there and they'll work and they'll work and they'll work. And then they'll get the truck. And for like a month, they love their truck. And then 3 months later, it's just kind of their truck. But like, what was the work you did getting up to that truck? If it was miserable and you hated it, wow. Well, I'm sure it was years of hard work. That sucks. But what if you could find something you enjoyed? I think the journey is where you spend a lot of time. And that's for me as like, I want to be able to be in the pursuit and love that aspect. But that's kind of my, if you don't know, that's why I chose this name. That's why I chose the name Pursuit Health and Performance, because I feel like even your health and fitness is a constant pursuit. Like it's different stages. When you're 60, you're pursuing something different. When you're 70, you're pursuing something different. When you're 80, 90, you're pursuing something different, like just mobility, just able to walk, just health metrics, and then you die. Like that is life. Your pursuit changes, but the actual pursuit never stops or shouldn't ever stop. So that's also why, like in our logo, not this one, but it says where the pursuit never stops. It's a constant thing. Anyways, this episode specifically is about growing your arms and your legs, which has nothing to do with what I said in the beginning, but I've got that question a couple times since starting this podcast. So just wanted to throw that out there. If you have seen my physique, you will know that I actually have pretty good legs. Now they're not huge. I know some people have these like freaking tree trunks, but I actually have pretty good legs. You know, I don't show them off like a whole ton. There's definitely people that have better legs than me, but that is an area that I'm pretty proud of. I was an athlete my whole life, but I didn't actually start working my legs like in the gym purposefully until 2015. But since then, I've been very good about consistently hitting them. Now, my training has switched. I've had high intensity interval training, like sports performance, explosiveness, martial arts. I did a little bit of endurance training. So not all 8 years has been just like grinding to get my legs like a bodybuilder, okay? So they probably could have been better if that's just the whole route, but I only cared about creating like a good physique, not necessarily a great physique. When I did my last photo shoot for fitness modeling, which was like, I don't know, 2019, I mean, I probably had one of the best packages, like physique packages I've had. I think that my legs are probably now are about the same size, but you guys want to probably know what exercises are the best. And so I'm going to give you a little bit of DL. So I don't think, and this may be kind of not what you wanted to hear, but I don't think there really are three best exercises. That's a really hard thing to say, because what's best for one person, it might not be for another person, but I will give you guys some tangible to take away with, because I know you probably watch this episode or listen to this episode because you're like, well, I actually want to know the exercises. So I'm going to give you my exercises when I had the best physique I've ever had and kind of what that training split looked like. So let's rewind a couple years ago. So let's say 4 years ago, back to when I did my photo shoot where I was published in a magazine and I brought in a really good package of my physique. It's, if you look on Instagram or Facebook, that's from that photo shoot. And really it's, I know it sounds weird. It's about the same physique I have right now. It's just substantially leaner. My physique really hasn't changed that much. I maybe had a little bit more muscle, but I was doing a lot of high volume hypertrophy. And I think that one exercise that was probably my go-to exercises was a walking barbell lunge. And here's a couple of different reasons. So some type of lunge variation. I actually think nowadays doing a Bulgarian split squat or some type of split squat, which is basically you're just in a lunge position, is the best for your quads. Okay. Now I did barbell step back reverse lunges, which is probably my second favorite variation of lunges. I used to do walking barbell lunges, like barbell on my back, and I'd walk for 10 reps, turn around and walk for 10 reps. So 20 total. The benefit of that is a couple things. Number one, your heart rate gets super freaking high. Okay. So you're getting some cardio, it's some high intensity interval training for sure. You're taxed. Another thing is it's very, very athletic. Like lunging is one of the most athletic movements because we're bipedal humans and that's how we walk and that's how we hike. And so being very strong in that single leg, foot, one foot in front of the other position is awesome. And guess what? I always thought that it made the most sense to walk forward because that's the direction we walk. And I know that that was beneficial because I used to go on these hikes, wear weighted vests, and just ruin everybody. Like if I can lunge, I think I got up to lunging like 275 pounds for reps. So you can imagine if I could lunge that on with a barbell plus my body weight, and I go on a hike and I have a 30-pound weighted vest and I just have these huge steps, my body's like, and right. So I used to do that, but then I realized after a long time that it was getting a very specific part of my glute, probably stronger than my quad, especially because I would take pretty big steps. Also I felt it pretty evenly, but like I definitely felt sore in my glutes. Even yesterday, instead of doing split squats, which I normally do, I do split squats. I just did extra legs this week. I did step back reverse lunges with a barbell. Okay. Sets of 20. So 10 each leg, same thing. Heart rate's up, really, really just pumped workout. But like, dude, my butt is so sore today. And I know that's where I feel it. Now my glutes are probably not as trained as my quad just because I do a lot of things like walking incline on a treadmill. And I do a lot of legs, sleds and stuff. Probably more, when I say legs, quad specifically, more than any other muscle group. And so I would say that probably doing some type of split squat is the best to hit quads. When I do split squats, I feel it in my legs and the burn more than any other thing. And there's a couple reasons for that. I mean, number one, I think that like you can play with where the pressure goes. So if your foot's out more and you're dropping your knee back, you're going to hit your glutes. If you're dropping it kind of straight down, it's hard for me to show you guys on the podcast. I have some YouTube videos that show the difference and I've explained it with our clients, but like you could do a split squat where you're hitting your glutes more, your chest is down and you're more like pushing your glutes like back to the bench or whatever your foot's on versus like a traditional split squat would be just like dropping your knee straight down, letting your other knee, the forward knee, come more forward and it's more quad focused. That I think is the lowest barrier of entry to getting big legs because anybody can do a split squat. Like you can hold onto a PVC pipe. You can go partial range of motion. You don't have to add any weight. telling people to do a walking barbell lunge, I think, is very challenging for a lot of people just for the balance. Loading it up makes more sense than holding on to dumbbells, even with lifting straps, which is why, right? Like, I'd have to hold on to 130, 40 pound dumbbells in each arm to be able to do what I did with the barbell. So it's not very realistic. Even with lifting straps, it would just be really, really, really challenging. And then, you know, you have both dumbbells swaying as you lunge. So that's kind of why I wanted to go really, really, really heavy. The step back reverse lunges are maybe a little bit better than the walking lunges because there's more time under tension. Like if you, and I used to do this with my in-person training clients, which is pretty cool. If you actually take a barbell on your back and you're walking and your foot hits the ground. So imagine I'm like taking a step and my foot hits the ground and I would actually time like how long is the pressure on that foot for? It was like 2 or 3 seconds. Like they'd do it, drop down, go up. Versus the step back reverse lunge, you have to go slower because there's just a little more stability. You don't have that like momentum, like stepping into it. And I would say, well, let's just do a step back reverse. And they were always on that foot, like time under tension, a second or two more. So that is one thing I think about the step back reverse lunge is there's more time under tension generally. Although the positioning might not be more optimal as far as like walking forward. The other thing I like about the step back reverse lunges is there's a little more knee stability happening. Like your glute med, the outside butt muscle, and then your groin, they have to stabilize your knee from doing this side to side. And I can't show you because I'm in my chair, but a side to side motion, you'll see some people where their knees cave in or their knees go out too much. You have to be very cognizant when you're doing step back reverse lunges, but you can kind of manipulate your knee a little bit more, which I always really, really, really like. The split squat's kind of the same thing. It's just more quad dominant. So number one, I would say the split squat. Number two, I would say sleds. Super underutilized tool. Very, 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 very underutilized. I go to, I have my garage gym, of course, but I go to LA Fitness or a sport or whatever you want to call it. And they have a sled there and they have this big turf and nobody's ever on it. There's like some people that are on it. I go there. I'm there for an hour and a half. I never see anybody touch it because sleds suck. Sleds are brutal, but we use sleds with a lot of our GPP, which is just stands for general physical preparedness for our military clients getting ready for their PT tests. And it is the sleeper that nobody does. If you want to get really, really good at your run and your PT tests, especially ACFT, do sleds. And the reason is it's such low impact, but it is such a brutal workout in so many directions. So the other day I did 10 sets of pushing the sled forward and then pulling it back and with a minute rest in between, and my heart rate was basically at 95%. And my legs hit failure on set 7. So 7, 8, 9, and 10, I like had to take a break mid thing and they were just so full of blood. So I got hypertrophy. I got explosiveness and power. I got a little bit of endurance that can build some strength, especially if I'm going up heavier, which I didn't. I got high intensity interval training. So my VO2 max and cardio got better. And guess what? Very low impact. I have a meniscus thing where I can't run. Okay. Which I know would be problematic if you're doing a PT test, but I can't run without pain. I can run, but it's just not optimal. I also have a back injury, so I can squat and I can deadlift, but I am limited to like how heavy I can go. And I just don't want to risk it. And I think a lot of people are like, well, I'm injured. I have this and I have this. Dude, a sled is such low impact. Like I used to work at F45 where sleds was like a main thing we did. We had people that were pretty jacked up, able to do sleds with no pain. But it's working all the muscles that they want to work with a squat and a lunge and whatever, but you're taking out the other components. No loading your spine, no shear force, no impact on your frail knees, just pushing and pulling. But you're working so many components. So I'm a huge, huge, huge fan of sleds, pushing, pulling. I see people that pull it with a rope, anything sled. I think one thing we use, I think it's called like the stealth sled. And it's just basically one that you could put in your truck and you can put a weight or your car, whatever, trunk. And you put weight on it and you take it to park and you just pull it and walk around and or you go uphill or downhill. It's such a simple tool, but it's so effective. And the reason I say that's secondary because so many people that want good legs, they also have other goals like burn fat and build muscle. And it sends such a big hypertrophy. Like when I did sleds, it was more muscle break. Like I could feel more blood pump and hypertrophy than doing split squats. Although I think split squats, it's easier to add more tension and do it slower. So you know what? I have both in my weekly routine. And then I would say that the third one and probably most effective would actually be like some type of front squat, like a barbell front squat, preferably, even though that's probably not the best movement, tied with a hack squat. So a hack squat is just because of the position of the knees. It's just kind of like a split squat. It's a dual leg. I think it is better than leg press because your knees track forward a little bit more. There's tons of different variations. I usually use a hack squat machine. I feel like it's very difficult and my legs, my quads specifically really, really have to work. I'm not sitting my butt back. Actually, I'm more at like a 90 degree angle with my knees. So I'm not working my glutes. The problem with doing you may say, well, Stefan, what about a leg press? Yeah, but the way people do it is it's not super quad dominant. If you were to get your legs narrow and put them down on the leg press, yes, you could. It's not a bad tool. Again, you're taking your back out of it, which is not ideal for most people, but if you have a back injury. But like front squats, you understand you're gonna have a limiting factor, right? Limiting factor is holding the freaking weight up like this because front squats work your core more than they do your quads. Just FYI, okay? That's why people can't front squat as much as they can back squat. And that's why people can leg press more than they can front squat and back squat. Your limiting factor is your core. But what are you trying to work? Your legs or your core? You might say both, but if you're really trying to get good quads in bodybuilding, I actually think a squat is not the best. I really do. I think a barbell back squat is not all it's copped up to be. And I had my injury doing barbell back squats, freak accident back in 2019 after my photo shoot, actually, a couple months after. And I will tell you right now that like, I don't think that's the biggest contributor. If I just did split squats, sleds, and like, I don't know, hack squats or a seated leg extension for an auxiliary, like that's it. That's all you need. So those are the three that I would highly recommend. Not every gym has sleds. So just like lunge variation, I think single leg stuff is not utilized as much as it should. I think people get in the whole squats and they see on Instagram, people doing like goblet squats, squats. That's fine. But we don't really move like that in real life. We kind of move on single legs. Like, I mean, very rarely. So I think that is probably not the most optimal to building quads. Just FYI. As far as your arms, I'm going to give you a little bit of insight. Number one, most of your arm is made up of your tricep and your delt and not your bicep. So I see a lot of guys that like work their biceps, but if you look at like how your arm separated, it's like 2/3 tricep. But the problem is when you're standing like this, right? A front view, you can't really see the tricep that much. You can kind of see the bicep, but then really you can see the delt. So if you want really good looking arms, you should actually work your triceps and delts more than your biceps. I'm probably not the person to really talk about arms. I think I have very, when I flex, and I think there is a difference. Like if you look at me in a shirt, you're like, ah, oh, he's fit. He has a good arms. But I know guys that are in the fitness industry and even friends that have better arms than me. I don't have that great of arms. Now, when I flex, I think I have very good shape. I have like that baseball peak bicep. I do actually have a really good tricep. I have like striations and all the cut in it, and it's a pretty good size. My shoulders, not so much. I've had torn labrum, torn rotator cuff. I deal with a lot of tightness in my shoulders, specifically my left in the last like few years. I have like some lat tightness and some rotator cuff stuff that causes impingement. So I don't work my shoulders as much. It's probably one of my weakest areas actually. But I still know how to work them. I'm probably not I'll just be honest with you guys. I'm probably not the expert on working your arms. There are some things I'm very, very good at with like certain body parts. But I will say this, I've been dedicating the last like 6 to 8 weeks of working my arms more because I know it's a neglected area, which seems weird. If you look at my physique and the pictures I post on my Instagram stories and stuff, I have a pretty good back. I have a really good chest for my size. And trust me, like there's not a lot of guys that have like the full pec. Chest is sometimes a really hard area. I have a very good chest. I know that. I have very good calves, good quads, pretty good abs, not as lean as I want to be. So like I'm very well balanced. Like I could probably do a natural show and place like top five within 2 months. I really do believe that. But my arms have been lacking. So basically all I've really been doing is a couple different exercises. I'm just going to go, I'll tell you what I've been doing. So number one, I've been doing incline curls. So if you're sitting down at an incline at like 45 degrees, you let your arms hang and just like incline curls. And part of the reason I think that's really good is your bicep is in a lengthened position, right? Your shoulders extended a little bit. And I just feel like it's so much isolation. My arm doesn't move. Yes, you could do a preacher curl. You could do stuff like that. I've just really gotten a super good pump, and I've noticed actually a change in my arm since I started, which is pretty crazy because I've been lifting for so many years that I'm like, man, my progress is really slow. But this was a specific muscle group where, you know what, it actually grew pretty fast. Another workout that I've been really liking for my biceps is actually doing the opposite. Well, actually pelican curls too. So it's the same thing as an incline curl, except your arms are out a little bit. So just hitting different angles of the bicep. And then another one where your chest is on the incline bench, like almost doing like a chest supported row, but my arms are hanging down in more of a shortened position. And then I'm doing curls there. So that's like all I've been doing. And yes, I do lat pull downs and like pull ups and stuff like that. But as far as just isolating them, incline curls are definitely my go-to. Sometimes I'll switch it up and I don't make it super complicated. I literally just think high volume. I'm not somebody that cares to curl like 60-pound dumbbells. I don't think that really is like, I've seen a lot of guys get like bicep tears and stuff. I just don't think that's super optimal. I'd rather try to do a 100-pound weighted pull-up where I'm not just isolating my bicep. I'm using other muscles too. But I do go heavy sometimes and I switch it up. I think it's good. But again, you can grow by just having like slow squeezes with moderate tension and high volume. So I might do like 4 sets of 12 and then get a thick black band to do 100 reps of curls just to like get the blood in there. And that's worked for me. Triceps, one movement that it works better than anything else is a parallel. You do them on parallettes. It's like a press out. And I wish I might drop the link below because it's so hard for me to explain, but basically you're supporting your body weight almost like in a push-up position on a parallette. And you can do it on a Smith machine too. And you're going all the way down like a French press and then pushing your body weight up. Okay. So you're getting the same type of workout doing like one of those, easy curl bars on like a French press. So you're laying flat on the bench and then you're doing like a tricep French press or skull crusher, whatever you want to call them. Same movement, just much, much, much more tension. That is like numero uno for sure. I don't think cable rope extensions are really that beneficial for me. I never felt like I really got the greatest workout out of them. The number two, I would say, is probably some form of dip. Now, I wish I had this from Rogue. I have their Matador, which is a dip bar, and it's just like set, like just, you know, it has two pieces of metal and you can go in a little bit closer and a little bit further out, but like the metal doesn't move. Now they have a new attachment where you can actually go like four different like spaces, like wide or narrow. I think that's really good. Yes, it is more based on your shoulders, but you're hitting your tricep really effective too. And if you don't know anything about the tricep, every time you're hitting your shoulders in like an extension of the elbow, you're working both. Like, I mean, anything like with gravity, right? Overhead. So for me, I feel like that's very beneficial. It's very functional. That's like one of the only movements I really ever do. And then I hit it when I'm doing, you know, shoulder press, bench, stuff like that. I don't isolate my tricep a lot. I do big compound movements. And then I said like the parallel press downs, or once in a while, I might take a single rope and just do like, you know, tons and tons of reps, maybe four sets of 25. Like a single arm, right? So I'll take the rope and instead of doing like where you spread it apart at the end, I'll just hang on and just do like a single extension as heavy as I can. But really I just do one movement, isolating movement with my triceps. And then my shoulders, I do lew raises. If you don't know what those are, I can post a link below too. But basically it's a lateral raise where you're going all the way up and then you're rotating it externally at the top. And this is good for shoulder mobility, but it also gets you the full range of motion. I do them very slow and try to get as much rotation in my shoulders as possible. And then I've been really big into doing calisthenic stuff. Now, it's probably not the best to grow your shoulders. I would say the best to grow your shoulders is probably a dumbbell shoulder press, seated, back supported or not. And the reason I think they're better than a barbell is because a barbell, you are using other things. You're using your core. It's a great compound movement. But you're using your core, you're using your back, You are using other things to get that weight up and you're not really isolating them. So what I like to do is actually just sit up in my chair, no back support. Because if you have a back support, like at the gym, dude, you could press 20 more pounds in each arm. No back support. I'm just like letting my core be straight and I'm doing seated shoulder presses like that. And that is a very, very beneficial exercise. And I just do a ton of sets. I'll do them with kettlebells. I'll do them with dumbbells. Sometimes I do them with a barbell. Yes, like a single barbell in one hand just for balance and stability. And that's it. And it's not super complicated. Now you might be asking like, well, how many sets, how many reps? This is very dependent on like how much time you have in the gym, what your split looks like, how many years of experience. But I've always been a high volume guy. And here's what's good and bad. There are people that are like, you got to lift really heavy. Well, I have a really good physique and I don't lift super heavy. I really don't. Does it mean I never lift heavy? No, but I feel like when I lift, again, I have a back injury and some other things. So I feel like when I lift heavy consistently, I'm doing it just so I can lift heavier. I don't think there's really a lot of transfer to the things that I like to do. I think if I want to transfer to the things I like to do, I need to be like moderately strong, but I probably need to have better endurance and cardio than anything else. Cause like paddleboarding, hiking, mountain biking, those things don't take like these huge, like, oh, I deadlifted 500 pounds. It is cool to say you did it, but I don't see like a whole ton of transfer. Even when I did jiu-jitsu, I was very, very, very strong. And I was a strong individual compared to most people, but there's people that do way better numbers in the gym that I'd roll on the mat and destroy them. So to me, I don't let my ego get to me. I've already had bad injuries. So I just don't have a desire to be like insanely strong. Coach Mike, our head coach, is a freaking ox and he never gets injured. And that's good for him. And I do work on my strength. I really, really do. But that's not my main concern. I'm not going to lie to you guys. My main concern is getting a good physique and looking good. Do I have performance sprinkled in? Absolutely. The only thing that I've been really, really focused on for my performance is my mobility. And the hardest part about doing high volume hypertrophy, which is like lots of sets and reps at moderate to baseline heavy weight, is you do get tight. Like you're tearing down those muscles, you're repairing them, you're growing muscle. And so if you don't keep your flexibility and mobility training very, very consistently, it's challenging. And right now I was doing like a 3-day split and then cardio mobility on the other days. But recently I've transitioned to basically doing bodybuilding, but with mobility. And I really like it. I just pick like one-ish muscle group and I do a 2 compounds, maybe 2 auxiliary movements. And then I just do like flexibility and mobility. So it's just kind of like traditional bodybuilding, but with some end range mobility mixed in. And it helps me because I feel like a lot of my muscle groups at this point in my training career, I have to really break them down to see growth. Some people say, well, you could just like do 3 sets of 12, but do it twice a week. And it's the same thing as 6 sets of 12. No, it's not. Like go ahead and do 3 sets of 12 on Monday and Thursday. And then next Monday, just do 6 sets of 12 and tell me that you feel the same amount of muscle breakdown and soreness. Like it's not the same. No, not soreness. Soreness is not the only thing that is that you should focus on. In fact, it's not necessarily a indicator of a good workout, but I can see these results. Like for me, I feel like I need to lift pretty high volume. Now I can't just keep doing 6 sets and 7 sets and 8 sets. That's how you get injured. Don't do that. But I know when my body it just needs a little bit more. And I always come in with a better physique when I kind of isolate muscles. I mean, why do you think bodybuilders do bodybuilding splits? Now you might ask like, Stefan, are you trying to do bodybuilding? I'm a little bit confused. I would say that I've always been functional fitness. A lot of our people, we train tactical fitness, which is not how I'm saying. But right now, I think my thing is like functional bodybuilding with a focus on mobility, which means there is a little bit of HIIT training in there. There's a little bit of like movement and mobility stuff, even during some workouts, but it's mostly aesthetic. But the big key is I lift in supersets in almost everything. So I go like, you know, pull-ups and squats and I superset those, or split squats and bench press. Like my heart rate is freaking kicking while I'm working out. And you might say, is that the best to grow bigger arms, bigger legs, or more muscle? Yes. And here's why I think it is. most people are like short on time and they feel like they can't get enough volume in the gym. But if you're not really resting as much, and I'm not saying don't rest. If you're doing squats, rest, you know, 90 seconds to 3 minutes, like 2 to 3 minutes is probably a good rest time. But all everything besides like squats, deadlifts, lunges, like these big compound exhausting movements, you should be supersetting everything else because you can get more sets and reps in, which means more volume, which means more time under tension, which means more muscle breakdown and more repair. So bigger muscles. I see some people that go in and they're in the gym for 60 minutes and they get like a few things done. I'm like, dude, if you were to just go in there focused, you'd be able to get so much more. And almost everybody that's trying to build muscle is also trying to burn fat. So they want to be big and jacked, but they also want to be lean. You can kind of do that at the same time and body recomp, and your nutrition matters a ton, but like it's also very based on what exercises you're doing and how you train. I don't put a lot of extra cardio in my routine because I superset things and I lift at a high intensity. And I can even tell that over the past 6 to 8 weeks, when I've been a little more focused on just like hypertrophy, I could tell I'm getting bigger. I could tell that I'm growing my muscle. And the cool thing is I stay really shredded while I do it. I stay pretty freaking lean, which allows me to have more dietary freedom. And I don't have to be like, oh, I do my cardio in the morning and then later at night I lift. I've done that at this point in my life. I feel like I don't want to make the time for that. I want one session, 60 to 90 minutes in the gym, 5 to 6 days a week, and that's it. And that's a lot of training. I don't really want any more than that, but I have to fit all my goals in there. Hypertrophy, AKA muscle growth, a little bit of strength, some flexibility slash mobility, and then also some cardio. And with our first responders, I would say a lot of you guys are in military need that. You need to be multifaceted, multifunctional. But what you're doing is you're doing like just bodybuilding and then you have like mobility days or then you have cardio days. And that's not bad, but I think there's a better way where you can get it done. And this is the problem. Imagine you miss a day. Well, now you're all jacked up. But if every day kind of took care of like a lot of the components of fitness, although we might be focusing on different muscle groups, if you miss a day, it's not the end of the world. But like if you have like back and biceps, chest and triceps, you know, quads and hamstrings or whatever, and you miss a day, it's like another 7 days till you hit that. And then if you miss a mobility day and then you're getting tighter, I feel like my training has been a little more, I don't want to say full body, but full goal, right? Like all my goals are tied into one and I'm sprinkling it in. And the only saving grace that allows me to do that is I do train frequently. I probably train 6 days a week, most weeks. Sometimes I train five, depending on if I need rest. But like, if I miss something, whoop-de-doo. I'm doing 4 workouts that are more isolated muscle group and then a full body. So even if I were to miss, and I do that because like, even if I were to miss an arms, right? And you're like, oh, Seth, you're trying to grow your arms. Cool, I'm going to do a full body. And I can change things on the fly. Like, you know what? I miss my arms. So instead of doing the legs, since I already hit my legs, I'm just going to do like extra sets of arms. Now I'm more well-rounded, right? See that adjustment? So those are the best exercises, I think, for your legs and your quads, guys. Split squats, some type of sled, some type of hack squat for your quads, for your biceps. I think like an incline curl is really good where you're laying on your back on an incline bench. Maybe some like pelican curls where your elbows are out. And then chest-supported incline curls. Again, it's hard to cheat and like swing your elbow, which it's a lot of bicep isolation. I like doing lew raises and then probably seated seated shoulder press, dumbbell, barbell, whatever. You can do back supported, right? That way your core is also not in it. Totally fine. I like my body to work as a unit as much as I can. Sometimes it's okay to isolate. There's nothing wrong with it. But I feel like, you know, I switch it up. Maybe 1 week I'll be like, oh, I'm going to do back supported. And the other week I'm like, I don't want to. Maybe I'll do half my sets supported and half of them not. And then when it comes to triceps, like I said, I really only do the parallel like burnout. And dude, every time my triceps are sore and I could tell the difference as I've been implementing those, it works very, very well. And then maybe once in a while, I'll do like a single arm rope extension for like a ton of reps. That's it. And if you actually look at my exercise library over the last year, it doesn't really change. And I think that's a big problem with people trying to grow muscle. Is I hear it all the time. I just get bored with my routine. Okay, we'll do it anyways. Like, do you say, I just get bored with my job, so I need a new job? And there are people like that, and they are like job hop. But we all know that that's probably a really terrible idea. Just like you shouldn't exercise hop. Like the same training that I do as far as what workouts I do, you should probably be doing basically the same movement. Now your intensity, your rest time, your sets, your reps, and your weight will all change. But like the movement's good. Don't change it. You know, sometimes, yeah, we got to change it so we're not bored mentally. But like if it tears down your bicep, it tears down your bicep. Like, I mean, you can't just, it's not this continuous process where you just get bigger and bigger and bigger and stronger for 30, 40 years. It's, unless you're on performance enhancing drugs, it's not how it works. But like the same exercises I was doing in 2015 when I got out of the military, I'm doing them now a lot. I mean, my training's changed a little bit, but like a squat's a squat. A lunge is a lunge. A sled push is a sled push. Like we can all get in shape doing those. It's more figuring out, if you really want to know how to get in shape, it's more figuring out how you can consistently do those week after week and get your recovery process on point. And then just, you have time on your side, because most people don't. Their recovery shit, their nutrition shit, and their training is inconsistent, even though they're like, oh yeah, I go to the gym quite often. No, you don't. You're not going 5 or 6 days a week. Like if you asked me the last time I took 5 days off the gym, I couldn't tell you. I don't know. I did 5 years ago. I don't know. When I got COVID, unless I've been like actually sick, I don't know. Even on vacation. Yep. You heard me. Not even on vacation. Well, why? Because I know that consistency is actually the thing that's going to keep me in the best physique. And I like training. So, you know, I got both things going for me. So hopefully this episode was helpful. If you guys are curious about how to get a program that's very customized to you, because I know there's a lot of information in here and a lot of like ifs, ands, and buts, but that's how training is. I can't sit here and say, you should do this, right? You need a kind of more of a self-assessment. But it doesn't mean that your program has to be this like super convoluted, special sprinkle fairy dust on a thing. It could be kind of generalized, but you could get really good results. So if you need help creating a custom program, you know where to hit us up. You can go to thepursuithp.com. Check out our testimonials. Check out our transformations. Book a free call with yours truly or one of our coaches. And we'd like to just see if we could help you. We've had a lot of success, guys. We've had 500 transformations in 2 years, basically solely online. We do have some in-person people that have crushed it. But like, man, dude, we have done a lot better than I thought we would do. And I was very confident. But like my coaches have blown it out of the water. And part of the reason is it's customized to you. And like I said, the biggest component is the accountability and making sure that you can stay, the accountability helps you stay consistent. Consistency helps you build muscle and physique over time. So really we offer a super high level of education and accountability. And that's why we've had so many people in our program with like different backgrounds, different age, races, sexes, heights, weight, careers, you name it. And they've all done really good, because our coaches are experienced enough to create it customized to you. And so if you feel like, hey, I want kind of what you guys are offering, I feel like I do need somebody, this is my pitch to you. Whether you work with us or not, I highly suggest you get a coach one time that's really good and really knowledgeable. And if you work with them for a pretty good chunk of time, like we work with a lot of our clients for 6 to 12 months, if you work with us for an extended period of time, the chances of you continuing to be consistent on your own and lift for 5, 10, 15, 20 years is actually really good. If you do these little like 3-week challenges and 6-week challenges and all that, the chances of you like continuing to do it on your own when you're done is very minuscule. So if you feel like you're struggling with consistency, or you've been program hopping, or you kind of do this and you fall off and you kind of start a diet and you lose motivation, dude, stop beating your head against the freaking wall. Get some help. Do it once, buy once, cry once, get a good coach, and then never have to think about it again. And I've done that with business coaching. I've sat there and got really, really good coaches that were super knowledgeable. Do I need a business coach the rest of my life? No. In fact, I started coaching people. But I, at the beginning, I had to kind of do that. I had to put myself out there. So this is my pitch. This is my plug to you guys. I give you this information, and you're more than welcome to use it on your own. You don't have to get anything from us, but we've had super good success with people that have realized, I do need a little help. I am at the point where I do need some accountability. And if that's you, book up a free call with us. You could also check me out on Instagram. I'm actually more on Facebook than Instagram, but I post on my stories every day. It's Stefan_Kunz_fit. So StefanKunz_fit. You can follow me on there. And then I also ask if you could do me a huge favor and give us a review on this podcast, like, subscribe, or share. I'd really appreciate it. I think this is episode like 76. And I've been going hard at this for a while. We post about one every single Monday. So you can see over a year we've been doing this, right? Yeah. And it's been great. And we're going to keep going, guys. But your support is much appreciated, because I'm here at 6 p.m. on a Sunday recording the podcast for you guys, specifically so you can take this information and apply it to your life. So I love you guys, and we'll see you next time.